Well, first serves will be key, I think, to get him off on a good start. He needs to be able to control the rally early on and not get pushed out too far wide in the court. I think it's important for him to just settle in with some good rhythm on that serve, which is very hard to do. Tendency is to rush in a situation like that.
Good point, though. Even though he's missed that forehand, he worked the ball around extremely well, and you've got to have the courage to go for it. And there's no point just sitting out there puddling the ball around against a guy like Rafa. He really has to step up to the mark and take those small opportunities.
You're asking for pain if you puddle the ball around.
There'll be a lot of running.
Second serves and 2 points to Rafa here. So, and both of the first serves in the net, that's when you're tight. Toss gets a little low. And
Bernard actually took the initiative about halfway through that point and went for the big forehand. And it just goes to show how good a scrambler Rafa is, though. He's able to get so many deep balls back and keep himself in the point. That's just energy, though. Footwork around the ball. He's ready to go right from the point. He steps around here. Such a massive cut at the ball every time forehand.
And lassos it right over his head with the racket. That was a good serve. That's the serve that Murray had so much success with last year against Rafa, and he snuck in 30-40. Behind it for some easy volleys, but pretty similar build between the two. That's probably a good play for him, and he was looking to sneak in. That's his tennis IQ working right there. Recognized it.
Well, three first serves. He's won the 3 points when he's got the first serve in.
Good positive vision there from Tomic. So he sees that he's hurt Rafa, and he's going to come in, but it's delayed. He doesn't necessarily sprint on the shot. He waits to see what happens.
And he's really probably looking to see if Rafa takes that second hand off his double hand backhand and could possibly get that floated slice backhand to play a high volley off. Seen of Bernard in the past, though, that is one of his favorite shots, and it's a world-class backhand, especially when he does want to pull that trigger up the line. Short backswing there. There's not a lot that can really go wrong with that shot.
Yeah. their advantage, Tomic.
Oh, that's the forehand that he can accelerate on, and you can't see it coming, seems like. He can kind of bump the ball. Next thing you know, he rips it and catches the world number one off balance. So add in.
Yes. I think he was in two minds there, whether to go for the dropper or ended up hitting a tad long. He really would like to get this first game under his belt, though. It'd be such a positive start to be able to sort of have a free swing on the next game, which would be Rafa's serve.
Oh. It's just missing. Tomic just challenged the call on the left near sideline. The ball was called out.
Just wide.
Second serve. Tomic has two challenges remaining.
Interesting so far. Nadal is the one who's running right now. Bernard is right in the center of the court and dictating play, which is a real surprise for me. Rafa had a forehand middle of this point where he put his grunt on it, and that's when he lets you know, I'm taking control of the point. Bernard got right back into the point, flattened it out.
Well, the shot that set him up there was that backhand down the line.
Yeah.
He wasn't afraid to pull the trigger.
Something. The break points against him a couple and long opening serve game.
Seven's Australian Open telecast made possible by ANZ. We live in your world. Panadol relieves, respects, body first, and Optus, the official telecommunications provider of the Australian Open.
Well, it's a great start, a promising start. It's and a couple of break points against him, all four perhaps that Nadal might break him. Now, for Nadal, what's he starting to think about already? It's the first time he's played Tomic, obviously.
Yeah, well, I think Rafa will be quite happy with that game because already Bernard would be thinking, well, I played a pretty good game and I was still lucky to get out of it. And that's the presence that Rafa brings to the court, the determination, that never-say-die attitude on every single point. So Bernard, though, he's hurt, to his credit, he's held a tough service game. He can get his, you know, mind back on trying to, you know, have a bit of a free swing in this game and really get a feel for how the left-handed serve's coming too.
Jim, tell us about changes to the Nadal serve.
Well, last summer, just before the U.S. Open, Rafa and, well, there's John Tomic, Bernard's father, but Rafa and his coach, Uncle Tony, decided that he needed a little bit more velocity on his serve. He wanted to get a few more free points, so he changed his grip the week before the U.S. Open from a little more open face at address to a little more closed face. And he gained about 10 miles an hour, about 16K in a week. And he had the guts and the confidence to put it into play at a major first, before even trying it out. It was really incredible. And it's not like the guy needed another weapon. He was already doing okay, right? Two majors in a row late. I mean, that's pretty
gutsy. Absolutely, anyone would take that. But that goes to show not only Rafa wanting to improve as a player and become a more complete player. You know, you see him get on the grass courts at Wimbledon, and one of the big things I really liked about him, he was always looking to come forward. He wasn't that typical Spanish player hanging back. He wanted to become a better grass court player.
There is Uncle Tony.
He's done a wonderful job with Rafa, really. He's guided him through his whole career. Even a couple of the tough times, they've bounced back so well since those knee injuries.
Rafa in interviews talking about being humble and staying humble, and it's a word that I know comes from his uncle. I know it's something that he keeps pushing into him. We got to stay humble, we have to stay hungry, and it's really led to greatness for him, that constant striving for improvement.
Here. The one thing Bernard does have in his favour playing against Rafa with the kind of spins that he does hit, Bernard is quite a tall kid. He's done a lot of growing in the last few years, so the ball's not totally getting out of his hitting zone all the time.
It's
good hitting, though. He wanted to attack and be positive out there, and it took some of Rafa's best scrambling to get out and get back in the point with that heavy forehand that he does do so often.
It's a great point about Bernard's size being a factor here, because Rafa's great strength is that big whipping forehand, which gets over your shoulders.
Absolutely.
You got to tell us how that feels versus what someone of his height, Murray's height, Utterling's height, They can handle it differently.
Rafa hits the ball firstly like no one else that I've ever seen or played against or practiced with. He hits the ball so heavy, off both sides, but especially his forehand. I think what makes him even better is that he's left-handed too, and he's able to hit that heavy, whipping forehand cross-court into a right-hander's backhand. And that's why he's probably better on a faster clay court when it's actually quicker conditions in Paris.
Mm-hmm.
And I think he's played some of his best tennis, especially against Roger Federer, when it's actually bouncing around a lot more to get a lot higher on guys' backhands.
Game on. So holds, and it is 1-1 in opening set.
One game on.
Well, he mixed this in so well, the slice backhand. He changes pace extremely well. Very similar to Andy Murray. Likes mixing in the slice backhand. And he can use it as an attacking shot and a defensive shot, which is always a good thing.
What's it feel like when Rafa's hitting that big spinning forehand up to your backhand?
It's extremely hard because, especially at my height, it was just under 6 foot. I feel like I have to really stand in the court and try and take it on the rise a little bit more, whereas it's sort of coming into Bernard's normal swing pattern a little bit better. Mm-hmm. So he can sort of lean into it a little bit more, whereas I'm sort of playing above my shoulders most of the time.
Yeah.
So, Leighton, what's the perfect height for tennis player, do you think?
It's hard to say. I think guys that are bigger, 6 foot, six foot four, 6 foot six nowadays, move so well, and they've got such big games, and I think that's where the game's really going to take off. And you know, you see Ivo Karlovic at 6'10", John Isner at 6'9".
Is
that's the range that Tom Hicks in, isn't it? The 6'4 to 6'6.
Yeah, absolutely. He moves pretty well. There's always been a little bit of question mark, I think, more so his movement probably out to his forehand.
Mm-hmm.
Has been a little bit suspect. But tonight he's moved pretty well, and he's staying in the court. He's not getting too far back.
Well, he's down a couple break 15, points 40. Here, but the strategy from him so far is perfect from my standpoint, because he's protecting himself from being exposed from the lack of movement that he has at this point, because he's young, he's not developed. He's staying right up on top of the baseline, shrinking the court on Rafa. That's the point Rafa wants all night long.
Gets the opening break.
And it's 2-1 in this opening set.
Nadal leads 2-1.
So Nadal with the break.
Please sit quickly. Ready for play.
It's been an intriguing opening three games. Tomic have a break point against Nadal in the second game of the opening set.
Please take any seat for now.
Just pay for your mistakes, though, at this level, don't you? Just a loose shot or two and Nadal all over the top.
Nadal's just getting his teeth into this, too, and he's now going to try and make this a very physical encounter if he can.
That's why a lot of guys feel like they've got to get off to such a good start against Rafa, purely because winning 3 out of 5 sets is tough against this bloke, let alone 3 out of 4.
Yeah.
You know, he has such a presence on the court. He's so determined for every single point. You feel like you've sort of got to go out there and overplay a little bit.
Now, losing the first set against Rafa in a major has been pretty much fatal. So we've been talking about the switch for Nadal and what he's done with his grip on his serve. Let's take a look at what it looked like last year. See how the racket face is open to the ball. He's going to carve around this ball. He's not going to be able to flatten it out as easily with that grip as he is tonight. And we'll show you why when we get a picture of the racket that he uses today, that grip he puts onto it, because he doesn't catch as much of the ball last year as he does this year. Now his racket, you'll see, pretty straight to target. It's not open at address. It's right down the line. His hand is turned over on top of that grip, and he can flat out jack that serve. It's a huge adjustment. This is a great angle to see it. You'll see that second serve, sometimes he opens it up, but that's pretty flat right there.
That was a perfect example, because the first he just missed wide was actually 207 kilometres per hour, and that's a massive difference. I just know when I've played him in the past, 9 times out of 10 on that juice side, you're actually leaning towards the tee.
Mm-hmm.
2 or 3 years ago, he'd always be just sort of hitting that typical left-hand swing serve down the tee to the player's back end. He would let it out that much. Well, we spoke about it last night, going back behind the player. When you guys like Monfils and Nadal that move so well, it's such an important play to go back behind these quick players. It takes their legs away from them. And as good a movement as Rafa is, he's flattened that ball out extremely well, and he can't quite get to it. you've got to remember, Rafa's always looking to get around his backhand and hit forehands as well from that backhand side of the court.
All
40, 30.
That was a chance there. He had the forehand he wanted, and I love the fearlessness. I love that he's willing to step up and take a big rip at that on a big point. I mean, he has to know, after watching Rafa through the years, Rafa doesn't give up on those points. He doesn't give you much. You have to take it. That's a great sign.
But Nadal holds, and he leads by 3-1.
Nadal leads 3-1.
Mistakes will happen.
Whose dishes will crush and burn?
New My Kitchen Rules.
We're ready for anything.
Time, Monday week, 7:30.
Did you do the cooking at home late?
A little bit. Beck does a lot more than me, that's for sure.
So 1-3. Fitzy, yeah, getting a bird's eye view of this at home, right on the court side.
Yeah, look, the way I see it, a couple of things. Bernard needs to use his off forehand a lot, hit it hard and flat. He's a flat hitter of the ball, so when he gets a chance to really nail his forehand off, go for it. Bit a la Leighton Hewitt. That's how Rusty tries to play him a bit too, I think. When he chips his backhand, he's got to be very careful, because as soon as he shows a sign that he's going to chip it down the line to Rafa's backhand, Rafa's going to get around and rip a forehand, and from there, he's odds on to win the point. So he's got to be careful of that. He's got to hit his two-hander more if he's going to go down the line, I think. And one other thing, Bruce, Rafa, I thought, was a bit nervous. You know, he came out, he's got more to lose. Bernard comes out and he's loose, goes for it from the start. He's handled the situation pretty darn well so far. But Rafa is now starting to loosen up a little bit, and the balls are getting a touch heavier now, which would suit Nadal.
Well, I think Rafa came out a little bit unsettled because, to be candid, he hasn't really played a match in this tournament.
You know, he's had a couple of very, very comfortable passages through so far. Marcus Daniel forfeited after being 6-love, 5-love down. I just don't think he wanted to get the double bagel. But even though Bernard's down a break early in this first set, he's actually been in every single game so far. Mm-hmm. The five games that we've played, he's had chances, he's had 15 30s or 30 alls in every one of these games. If he can sneak out of this one and still just keep that one break down, would be... Everyone knows that Rafa's forehand is his main strength. It's the shot that's going to hurt you the most, but I always feel the guys that do well against him are the guys that stand in and actually take it to his forehand and try and get it in there quick. And I think Bernard, as good as his backhand, and he loves playing the backhand up the line, I think he can step in with his height and really flatten that ball out and go hard into Rafa's forehand cross court.
Well, it's interesting. The guys that can typically really bother Rafa are the guys that have the power to do that. It's the Soderlings, it's the Murrays who can stand up on the backhand side and go cross-court with that backhand. And that's what Roger Federer did in London and really got Rafa first time, long time in the finals.
And I think for sure the surface definitely suited Roger in that one, because the ball was staying a lot lower than a high bouncing hard court such as here.
And he was able to rip that backhand cross-court with great effect.
Juice.
I'd probably put that shot away, I think, for most of the night. Rafa moves so well,
yep.
Both crossways and up and back.
Well, I do like that wide serve there for many reasons. But opening up the court and having that window into the Nadal forehand corner is a great reason to keep going to that wide serve in the deuce. It's awfully nice of Rafa not to put a hole through that.
Well, I think the wide serve on the deuce court is the one. If you're going to sneak forward, he's tried to sneak forward here and get a volley, but it's a lot harder to do because Rafa's in the middle of the court ready to set up on that pass. Whereas if he can sneak in on that wide serve on this side, on the deuce side, he can play a volley to the open court.
Right.
Forehand winners in this game.
And it's still not over yet.
Yeah, I'll tell you what, that is not a shot that I thought we would be seeing a lot of from Bernard. I didn't think you could see the forehand speed. He's beating Rafa. Rafa will be beating him in the spin department, the weight department, but getting out to that forehand I thought would be his biggest challenge tonight. That's pretty good.
Well, that's a good hold again. So, 3-2, one break in this opening set. Nadal leads. It's not a bad compliment, is it?
Well, they used to do that for you too, Jim, didn't they?
My wife still does. That's about it. Now it's just the sound of one hand clapping.
Lofoten.
Good move, though, there. To have a go, especially early in the game, to try and get up in the count. He's looked to get around and use his forehand into Rafa's forehand.
I came away from this tournament last year expecting a lot out of Tomic. You know, he really pushed hard in the second round against a quality player, and I expected when I came back to Australia a year later, this kid's going to be top 50 in the world, he's going to be a tour player, he's going to be established. What happened to him last year? Where did he go? He basically didn't play at all the second half of the season.
Well, in my mind, it was really bad scheduling. He should have been out there playing a lot more tournaments, 30%. Especially a lot of the bigger tournaments. He played quite a few tournaments leading into the French Open on clay, which is probably his worst surface, and then actually played Queens, won a round there, and then qualified for Wimbledon, and actually pushed Marty Fish, a good grass court player, in the first round in a tight three-set match. But he really didn't play a lot of tennis, and I think that can hurt you. He had an opportunity, and his rankings, it's definitely gone up, but mm-hmm. I think it could have gone up a real lot more, you know, coming into this Australian Open and sort of set himself up for a big 6 months, the first 6 months of this 2011 year.
But he wasn't injured, that I'm aware of.
As far as I believe, he wasn't injured.
Yeah, it's weird.
A lot of training.
Well, maybe it was a lot of growing and filling in and trying to figure out with a couple extra inches and some more weight on his body what that would do. You know, sometimes that can be discombobulating as well. You have to find your coordination again. Whatever the case is, if I come back here next year and he's ranked 199, I will eat Rafa's shirt.
Guess not. It's not a bad question. Where will he be ranked this time next year?
Yeah, well, it's a fair question. Even if he was to go down here tonight, he's going to gain some points from last year's second round appearance here at the Aussie Open.
I mean, you look at him now, he's a, and to my mind, he's a tour player. He's got to do the work. He's got to go get the points. He's got to go grind in some smaller tournaments. But he's ready, game-wise.
Wait,
so just floats out, Nadal holds. It's 4-2 in this opening set. And coming up after this match, Jürgen Meltzer, the number 11 seed. What strides he made at 28 years of age last year, now 29 against Marcos Baghdatis, a huge favourite here. Baghdatis, who plays so well here at the Australian Open, made the big run in 06, and they're coming up after this.
Nets for serve.
And I think coming up after this tournament, this year is going to be a big year physically for Tomic as well. Rafa's not ready there, so we'll get a reload. But I think his game is there, but I still think Tomic's got about another 2 years of hard yards at the track and in the gym to really get to where he's going to be physically and then see how good he's going to be, because we're not going to know, I don't think, for a couple of years.
Yeah, I think you're right, and I think he's not going to win a lot of matches all the time, though. Players are going to start working him out, and that's the real hard thing. When you actually get out on the tour, week in and week out, that first year can be really tough sometimes, and you have some average losses. But you've got to keep doing it. You've got to keep backing yourself out there and keep believing in what you're doing.
Love for you.
And this is where Rafa's so good. He doesn't give away any cheap points out here. It's only one break at the moment, and Bernard's played pretty well.
Isn't that amazing?
Lovely.
It feels like he's played a really good set, Tomic. He's lost 30 points. He's won 22. That's not a drubbing. And still, he's staring down the barrel of a 6-2 set here.
15-14.
It's interesting, though. Two of Rafa's forehand winners in this game have come from big forehands down the line to Bernard's forehand. And once Rafa gets that on song, then he's going to be very hard to beat in this tournament.
Yeah.
We made the point earlier, Leighton. He's been in every game, really. He's got to at least 30 in every game in this opening set.
Three good serves have got him out of trouble in this game.
Nadal's had 7 break points in the opening set, and he's been able to save 6 of them.
Well, first serve has been critical for Tomic. He's only won 2 out of 9 points when he's had to come with a second serve.
Advantage.
And his serves improved for sure over the last couple of years that I've seen at the Australian Open, but I still feel for his height. He could use his legs a lot more into his serve. I still think there's a lot of room for improvement.
Well, I think he's got to get some legs. I think he needs to get into the weight room and do some squats.
This is what down the line, and it's a double break.
New ball, please.
5-2.
Well, this is one of the greatest shots in men's tennis. He rips up on that ball so much, it's so heavy, he can go either way. You can just see the determination in his eyes every time he has a massive cut at them. And in my mind, it's one of the greatest ever.
Not about. Well, Rafa thought that Tomic was coming to the net there, so he tried to hit the lob instead of the big one between the legs.
Well, Roger's still got him covered for that shot, I think. For me, Bernard's an interesting player, though, because in this day and age, and especially kids growing up and watching right now, I think more and more younger players are actually trying to hit the ball a lot heavier with more extreme grips and really trying to get a lot more spin out of their racket. Whereas Bernard actually is quite conventional, really, with the way that he plays. He's very flat off both sides, which can be a good thing because you can flatten the ball out against the spin.
It's close, but it looks like it's just missing. Nadal was challenging the call on the right service line. The ball was called out.
Bruce and I were talking earlier today. We were watching Andy Murray, who has a pretty conventional grip on his forehand. We're puzzled over who else in the top 100 has a forehand grip like that. Good challenge there. Well, he's not in the top 100 yet, but Bernard has a pretty conventional grip, as you point out. But he doesn't hit it like Murray, who whips it to generate that topspin. But you reckon it's a good thing in developing kids to have some options, maybe a little bit more conventional grips, or you like the heavy? What's Cruz going to play with?
Cruz, who knows?
Yeah, that's what I'm asking.
Yeah, well, you know, the most complete player that I've seen is obviously Roger Federer.
Yeah.
And, you know, there's another young kid on the way up from Bulgaria, Dimitrov.
Mm-hmm.
He plays, basically has mimicked Roger Federer's whole game.
So a set point for Nadal here. It's
14
hard fought, three quarters of an hour. forced to break in the third and the seventh games. And gets it, so Nadal takes the lead. Third round encounter, Lord number one, six games to two.
Guy here, the blue hat, all the way down.
So about three quarters of an hour, that opening set, lots of break points. Nadal was able to force, got a couple of breaks, but Tomic was in just about every game there.
Nadal has been a racket to the stringer through the court, so it's on the way, but he didn't know the tension, or he didn't tell me the tension. It's there with the stringers.
So, you heard the umpire there? Off to the string or a racket, but didn't give them the tension.
15-love.
Well, he must have a standard tension that he uses and just sent that racket back. Get it restrung, come back fresh. Take about 20 minutes.
Classic Nadal point. He was on the defensive there. Bernard had him stretched all over the court. But Bernard went for the slice forehand in the middle of the court when he had the... He looked like he was actually in two minds whether he was actually going to go for the drop shot. And he ended up just pushing it back, and then Nadal went on the attack and really had Bernard doing all the scrapping from there. And this game's big for Bernard. He, he really wants to feel like he can get up in this set, to feel like he can put a little bit of pressure on Nadal's service games. And that's what does help about him serving first at these, in the first set he did as well. But he can open up a little bit if he can hold here.
Well, he's done pretty well with holding his court position. He hasn't really given ground to Rafa, which is a good sign.
40-15.
It'll be interesting to see what actually Rafa sent his racket away to get strung at, because my guess first of all would have been that he'd be getting it slightly looser for the night conditions, right. Here, a little bit heavier conditions at night time as it gets later, but he's hit two forehand returns very long, so maybe he's getting it a pound tighter.
So that ace, good way to finish for Tomic. It's one love in the second.
Quiet, please. A new wave is about to hit the bay. You won't know where, you won't know when. Home and away. Time starts Monday at 7.
And Luke Mitchell there, his brother Ben. Luke in the middle there with Rebecca Breeds, who's his real-life partner as well. Both at home away. You know Ben, his brother.
I know Ben. He came, Benjamin Mitchell actually came to the Davis Cup as an orange boy in Cairns in the last time we played against Belgium, only a few months ago. He's a really good kid. He's a level-headed kid. He actually qualified for Wimbledon Juniors last year and went all the way to the finals. So his brother obviously enjoys the tennis too, and hopefully we see Ben out here on centre court in the years to come.
It's your mum getting old. They look so young, those stars, don't they?
They are young, Bruce. That's reality.
Did you ever get paid for that Campino appearance?
No. I got to go to the Logies. That's about it.
No problem.
Oh. 15 love.
If he's able to flatten out that backhand cross court and try and take some of the time away from Nadal setting up for that big forehand, because Rafa does have such a big swing, he doesn't have a lot of weaknesses out there, but if he can flatten it out, and he's kept that ball pretty low as well on him, which is a good thing.
That's why I think that the backhand cross court for Federer is such a key shot. If he wants to ever rectify his record against Rafa, he needs to hit the hard flat one into Rafa's forehand. Rafa just in the backhand with options. If you go hard to it and you can get two hands on it, it's a firmer shot, it's a flatter shot. He's got more string to the ball at contact. He has to time it better on the forehand side because he's brushing it so much. So it's a handsier shot, it's a riskier shot when it's coming in hard and flat. Wow.
Brilliant. Couple of break points.
Well, this is where you really like to see Bernhard, if he does get the opportunity to have a go at a second serve here, to really 15, step up 14. And take his opportunity and have a crack. You don't want to die wondering out here.
I love that line. Never want to die wondering. Regret is such a terrible word. Well, here he is. Second serve. Yep.
He's done the damage for him beforehand, hasn't it?
Well, he's gone back behind him again, and he's taking his legs away, which is a good sign. I was a little bit worried there. He went backwards to actually return serve, the second serve. But he stepped up when he got that half opportunity when the ball sat in the middle of the court for his forehand. The first one did the damage, and then the second one he just finished it off.
So Tomic strikes the first blow, able to turn points into a game there. First blow in this second set, Nadal 6-2 opening set.
15 love.
It's a big game here. If we can consolidate this break and actually get to the change of events, knowing that he's up an early break in this second set, he feels like he's actually part of the match.
Here's something for you. Total points won. Nadal, 38. Tomic, 37.
And last time you looked at that, it was 30-22.
It's coming on. It's tied up. I'd still rather have the set in hand, of course. Captain Obvious, but...
But he served well this game as well, which has made life a bit easier for him.
That's a couple of the best minutes of tennis I reckon he's ever played. So just how aggressive will Nadal be here? He's a breakdown in the second set.
Took him a while to wrestle control of that point, but when he finally got a ball to hit, he pummeled it. And I think Rafa will try and up the ante here and try and make this a little bit more physical. Bernard?
If feel like he's got to try and take the court away from Bernard a little bit at the moment. Bernard's keeping his position right on that baseline extremely well.
He needs first serves, Rafa, doesn't he? Because the positioning right now, that battle is being won by the Aussie. You see Tomic on the right, 31% of his balls, he's striking inside the baseline. Rafa is well back. That's not necessarily unusual, but he'll have more than that typically because he's getting some short balls to punish.
And I think early on in tournaments, Rafa tries to be a little bit more aggressive. He tries to really work his way into the tournament by being a bit more aggressive against the lower-ranked players, and so far tonight he hasn't been able to do that as much.
Well, they mount a little, and first serve percentage not strong here for Nadal.
No, he's only got 50% of first serves in, and Leighton, to your point, Tomic's been in that 10 times in this match. Rafa, 3. Would not have seen that one coming.
And in the last two service games, he's actually hit 2 very average double faults for the world number one.
I wonder if he needs that racket back from the stringer in a hurry. Since he sent the racket, he hasn't won a game.
Jets first serve.
So went with a conservative first serve there. Put a heavy spin on that, just trying to get away from having to hit another second serve. So if I'm Tomic, I'm looking for a middle first serve here. Nothing too big. Something I can get in play. Now on the second, it's go time again. Some more aggression. Take it to the world number one. Why not? Boom.
That's a good point, no. He stood in and he went hard with that backhand cross court off the return and also the first hit that he got. And the slice was a good one.
It was a great one. Did you see Rafa start to run to the net because he thought it was going to be a drop shot?
He played it well. It was a good surprise tactic. And it's one shot Rafa has worked on, though. He sliced backhand. And I think purely because Roger Federer uses his slice so well that Rafa feels like he's got to actually make his a stronger shot.
Holding Rafa with that shot. Rafa is not reading Tomic's ball at all. Rafa's on his heels a little bit when Tomic's got something to hit.
30
break point. This be huge. Watch, well, you can't see Rafa from this angle, but he was nowhere near that ball. It's rare to see Rafa not even move for a ball.
Yeah, well, he's caught him by surprise by going so often with a big flat forehand down the line.
Good gracious, what a shot.
Well, I've thought about this match a lot today, but I didn't practice Tomic has a double break in the second set.
We went after it. He backed himself here. And he really had Rafa running ragged in that point. And he's gone back behind him yet again, and that's paid dividends.
Fitzy, you're right down there again. I mean, this is some moment, isn't it?
Oh, this is impressive. I don't care what anyone says. He is taking it a bit to Rafa. It's quite amazing.
Have you noticed any difference in Nadal?
I did think it was interesting that he served two. I think he's serving poorly. I haven't got the stats in front of me, but it looks poor, and he doesn't have a lot of weight on his serve. He's a tiny bit anxious. I mean, I don't think he probably deep down believes he's going to lose this, but I think Tomic is definitely taking it to him a lot more than he expected, and how he can keep those flat shots in, it's quite incredible. They're so flat. The forehand has very little margin, but he's got such great feel, Bernard, he just doesn't miss it.
But he's missed a couple here, hasn't he?
He's played two loose points here.
Love
I feel Rafa would still like to get up in the court a lot more, though. I thought he'd come out and try and be a little bit more aggressive in this set, especially after getting the first set. He's been able to get his teeth into the match. He knows what to expect from Bernard a little bit more.
He's lost his way from a confidence standpoint in this set. He's... You know, a lot of times confidence is shown in the miles per hour that you're hitting the shots and swinging. And Rafa in this set, 15, on average, his serve is down, well, it's down 9 miles an hour. Or, excuse me, 9 kilometers an hour. That's a pretty big gap on average.
Serves worked well for him, hasn't it?
It has tonight. He's hit his spot extremely well. And when he makes first serve, it takes the pressure off. Because Rafa's not always getting that first hit in the point. Great tennis, a good point all round by both players.
And Nadal gets one of the breaks back. So one of the two breaks back, Nadal serving 1-4 in this second set after he took the first in about 3/4 of an hour, 6-2.
Love.
And the racket came back, Jim, about 20 minutes spot on.
Well, this could have been part of the problem for Rafa losing the first 4 games of the second set. Bernard's play was the other part of the problem. What I like to see from Nadal. Coming forward and looking to attack. He does have great hands out there. He's able to play so many good drop shots, and he knows when to attack well. And we've seen it at Wimbledon over the last 3 or 4 years, where he's, you know, been able to obviously be the champion there twice and make another couple of finals.
Next, for serve.
Well, Rafa's a lot like Hugh Layton in that if he did play a lot more doubles, he would win slams in doubles. You know, he's just not going to play. He's too physical, but good hands and obviously a great competitor. It's a shame the game's too physical to allow players to do both now. You'd have the one, and then you stop.
I've
playing.
Only got one.
But you stop. Yeah, when's the last time you played doubles in a major?
Yeah, not for a while. But...
Right. Federer would have a lot, I'm sure.
Oh, that is beautiful.
There it is, tied up on the scoreboard, 45-46. But tightening up here in the second set a little bit. Boy, time and time again with Rafa, you will see him get down 4-love. And he doesn't ever, ever, ever concede a point, let alone a set.
And the main reason for it, I think, is he's obviously so determined out there. But it could play in the opponent's mind later on as the match gets tighter in a fourth set or a fifth set if the person or his opponent is actually serving for a big set or a big match, knowing that he's going to chase down every single ball out there.
points. Great points.
30-15.
More success with that backhand high in the atomic pocket. Driving across court to the forehand. 132K right off the line. And Nadal's really struggling to hold serve in this set. Hadn't done it yet.
Thomas is challenging the call on the left.
Bernhardt's going to challenge this.
Ball's got in.
Who was close down the tee.
Tomic has two challenges remaining. Nets for serve.
Well, the other night, Federer had problems holding serve against Gilles Simon for a spell. Got broken three times in a set. Broke twice as well.
I definitely think one of the keys, especially on the juice side, has been Bernhard's return a serve down to Rafa's forehand, because Rafa falls away so much to the backhand side.
Survives a break point, a couple of big serves helped him there.
Tomic leads four games to two.
Well, that's where he gets so much whip off that serve, puts a lot of energy into it every single time, and that's what comes from training so many hours on a clay court as well. He's got such a good kick serve out there that he can rely on so often, and to set up and really set the point up for his forehand. This is a really big game now for Bernhard. Say before
love
he tried to play the slice forehand again that floated long. That what's really impressed tonight about Bernhard is he's stepping into court and actually hitting through the every shot. He's not taking a backwards step. He's not falling backwards on any shot.
Signed by the odds on this match tonight. Tomic was $15 before the match, $61 at the end of the first set, $9 as we speak right now.
Good first serve there, he's gone wide again. It's worked well for him tonight, that wide swinging serve on the juice court.
You know, in the last round, Bernhard played against another left-handed Spaniard, Feliciano Lopez. Took him out. Lopez doesn't have the power at the baseline that Rafa does. Let's face it, who really hits the ball like Rafa? Yeah. And as a result of that, Bernard played a very different match from the baseline. He caressed the ball a lot more. He used more of those slices off of both sides. And that's where the Murray comparison comes in for me, because he's recognized that that's really not going to cut it against Rafa. He's really stepped up the ante on average from the baseline and has taken offense so he can hit shots like that at 161K.
And even though he's missed that one, it's a great play. He stepped into it. He's had a go. He had a good inside-out forehand. Not many guys would have got the ball back that deep with that much on it. And Nadal's movement is so good out there behind the baseline that he's able to make you play that one extra shot.
Leighton, in your mind, how many guys on tour have the ability to play sort of multiple strategies out there? Most guys tend to come with just kind of one style of game, right?
Pretty much. You feel like if they've got to start changing their game, then you're going to get on top of them because it's not their A game out there. And this just goes to show, this game in particular, how tough Rafael Nadal is to put away. He was 4-love down in this set. He looked gone for all money. And he fights for every single point. That never-say-die attitude, and for all the kids out there watching, it means so much to lay it on the line. A set's never finished.
Enforces a double fault and gets the breaks back. We're back on serve.
Tomic leads.
It's the coalface, isn't it? 20 minutes about, they say, to change the strings on a racket. Maybe he's changed the tension. We're still trying to actually work out exactly whether Nadal did change. It's Rafa's back. Whether he got it a little looser or tighter or maintained the same tension.
That racket's the one he got. He hasn't put it into play yet. When he got it, he just put it behind his bag and it still sits there.
Well, it's a good play here. He's gone back behind Bernard. Bernard comes up with the slice forehand squash shot, and he whips that ball in. And the string that he uses in his racket is actually, it's a heavy topspin string as well. So not only is he taking massive cuts out there, the ball dips so much from the string as well.
Tomic is challenging the call on the left baseline. The ball is called out.
So let's take a look at our Rolex review here. Yep. Confirmed.
30-love. Tomic has one challenge remaining.
Well, you don't want to leave those in the bag, do you? You may as well use them if you have them. Challenges. You said that last night. Have you tried that string?
No. I've had one hit with it.
Yeah.
It doesn't really suit my style of play too much because I try and flatten the ball out a lot more.
I'm exactly the same. I tried it for a week trying to convince myself.
Yeah, that it must be the right thing to use. But that's the interesting thing. All players are different. And racket types and also string as well. Very important for every individual player.
And there's Rafa's father, who's made the trip down here. So we got the two parents in attendance. He's chomping on that gum pretty good, huh? A little nervous.
40-30.
Oh, never say die from Rafa. That's been a little bit of the switch for sure. But that loose game for love from Bernard is really, that was the unforgivable part here. That's the one you'll lose sleep on, because you cannot take your foot off the pedal against Rafa. This is what happens when you do. A couple of weird choices, you know, fake drop shot slices instead of just trying to keep driving the ball through the court. Those are lessons to be learned.
Sensational point for all. Oh, Jacob.
Well, while I've been enjoying watching the number one player in the world and an 18-year-old, it's perfect. It's got people very motivated to answer our Jacob's Creek fan forum question, which is, who is the best teenage player ever? Online has been going off. Claudia says Boris Becker, of course. And Lani says, what about Jennifer Capriati? If you'd like to have your say, just head to www.yahoo7.com.au/JC Fan Forum as we now rejoin Jim, Leighton and Bruce.
We've got something to think about that. We had a discussion about that earlier today, but for all here...
I think this is going to be an important start now to this game, because that last point was incredibly play. It was a typical Nadal point, and it's going to be interesting how Bernard responds.
15 love.
Early in the third set, I'm going to call on you for the best teenage player ever. Okay?
I'll have a think about it.
Yep.
Looked to me at the end of that last game that for the first time, physically, Bernard was feeling the Rafa, the wrath of Rafa.
The punishment.
Yeah. And that's a shame for Rafa not to get the ball in play here in the first two points to exploit that and try and really punish him.
Well, it's well done by Bernard to stay composed as well. He had this 4-love lead, and it's got back to 4-all now, and he's come up with 2 good first serves. Make that 3.
Well, new balls helping out here, huh?
Well, we've talked about that one wide, haven't we, all night, and he's been very effective.
And you see the top 5 serve speeds of Tomic.
What a game. Rough run, certain, but... Bang, bang, bang.
Even he's enjoying that. Surprised.
So the first couple of points are crucial, you would think, at both ends. On serve, but 4 breaks of serve in this second set. Tomic led 4-love halfway through.
And look at Rafa as he's walking to the chair after the last game, kind of sheepish about all the good serving. A little surprised, but maybe even thought that last serve was a let. Who knows? But he's back to business here. 15 love.
Bernard mixes up his return position pretty well. He went back that time to give himself a little bit more time.
15 all.
Just in case Rafa put in the big swinger out wide. He got it back in play, and then Rafa's just missed this one just down the line. Big point here now. And that's when I think Rafa looks at his best. He's trying to take the ball a bit earlier there. He took it on the rise, and he backed himself. He was coming forward after this backhand, which was a good sign.
And that's a better pattern for him, too, going out to Bernard's forehand and avoiding allowing Tomic to hurt him with the cross-court backhand to his forehand. He really controls play if he's doing that, Nadal. That's the first time that Tomic looked a little slow to me in the rally.
He hasn't missed too many of those, really. He's been able to get a lot of backhands back in play. Good spring out of those legs. He's such a strong guy. That's what you get growing up on clay courts.
I think Tomic's ability to generate pace off the ground has been impressive tonight.
Especially on that forehand there, as you could see, he was pushed out wide there and he was still able to generate a lot of pace and put Nadal under pressure.
Pointed it out earlier in the match, his height makes a huge difference against the ball he's seeing from the world number one. He's able to handle that up high.
Safe hold. Up to 5-5 now. Well, you've described it, and so has Jim, as one of the great shots in the history of the game, the Nadal forehand.
Well, just how strong he is and the way that he brushes up and even how the racket can finish above his head like that is kind of unheard of, really. There's a lot of coaches around the world that when I was growing up, they would have never taught you to hit a forehand like that.
Love.
Well, that's a cheap error there. He got the ball that he was after. But sometimes you choose to go after it a little bit too much against a guy that moves so well as Nadal.
He's going to need his serve to get him out of this game, Tomic. He needs some cheap points here. That he's feeling the nerves. Those are some loose errors right out of the blocks here. Love 30. That's a bad miss on the serve, too.
Brings up three break points for Nadal to serve for this second set to take a 2-set-to-love lead.
You got an odds update for us?
I think that's 60. Just two poor games. 4-love, 5-all.
Just two poor games. You played two poor points and you can pay the price against Rafa. He's got you in a vice if you let him.
Throw one of them back with a good serve.
15-40.
But I'll tell you, if I was Tomic coming in and you could have given me this situation, down a set, but in the second, I would take it.
Out. Nadal is challenging the ball on the left near sideline.
It's a challenge, but that one was wide. So it'll be 30-40.
Bernard was able to change pace with that slice, short slice backhand, which actually brought the error out of Nadal. Point extremely well there. Rafa was waiting for the right ball to go after and take the initiative, but in the end he's just missed a wide again.
So back from love 40 here, when seemingly all was lost in this game.
Net second serve.
Well, that's the same forehand. He was just able to have a little bit more time on that one. He's got one of the best inside-out forehands the game's ever seen. His dad's pretty happy with that. Another break point.
So he's ground his way to the lead. Finally in the second set.
Nadal leads 6-5.
Day 15 years ago, Mark Philippoussis, a 19-year-old, beat the world number one in the third round on a Saturday night, beat Sampras. And as Al Michaels said, miracles can happen.
That was when the ice hockey was in 1980.
So who knows, but that was a night, wasn't it?
That thing sent shockwaves through the men's game.
Ready for play.
To see a player come out and overpower Pete Sampras. Hadn't seen anyone really bring the thunder quite like Flip did that night.
It's a long way back now for Bernard, but you really want him to step up to the plate now and keep hitting and keep going for it and back himself.
Good shot. Just back to Philippoussis for a moment. He looks sensational that night, but what about that green court? When you first see it again, gee,
15 love.
It jars, doesn't it?
Doesn't it? So bizarre. How the green courts were painted that color to mimic grass courts. This is so much easier to see the ball on the blue court. Contrast is so much better.
15-0.
Unfortunately, all the tapes that I'll be able to show my grandkids if I ever have any are going to be on those green courts. That's okay.
Rebound ice.
It's good to have them.
Pops.
Well, this is the moment that Rafa typically tries to just close this match out, tries to get off this court in about 15 to 20 minutes in this set, and he's so good at it. Look at that intensity. If you give yourself even a second to feel sorry for what just happened in the second set, this match can be over before a blink of an eye. You have to match this man's intensity from ball one. And Leighton, you've been on the other side. How hard is it to do that?
It's extremely tough. And one of my good mates, Peter Luchak, actually played him in the first round here last year in Nadal, and I don't think a lot of players realise how hard it is to play him over best of five sets. Guys can stay with him perhaps for a set at some stage, but to keep doing it for three out of five sets, it's near impossible. You can possibly play a set of your life and still not win the set.
And I pretty close to what happened that last set there for a while.
And in the US Open final last year, I don't know if there was a whole lot more Novak Djokovic actually could have done. I felt he played one of the better matches of his career, and he still lost in four comfortable sets.
So gets that early break. Starting to roll now for the really first time in the match.
Well, here are the second set highlights. Tomic really had his way early. But from 4-love, that one loose game, and Rafa started to wrestle control of the rallies. Started to punish him, moving the youngster all around the court. That's the spot that he's going to have to improve to get to the next level, Tomic. But he's shown in this match for me already that his game is pretty mature from a tennis standpoint. He just needs to add a few little physical elements, and then he'll really have a chance to see how good he can be.
Fitzy?
And you go ahead, Fitz.
Yeah, I think the accumulative effect now is starting. It's starting to take effect on Bernard. He's not quite as not quite moving as well as he was earlier. And I think, you know, two sets he stayed with him physically. The next step is three, four, and possibly five at some stage. He's definitely slowing down now.
Had the first hit and a lot of the first two sets he was getting the first hit in, and he was actually being the aggressor, and Dan was doing a bit of the defending. So then he's got a chance, Bernard, but now the tables are starting to turn. Rafa's starting to move him around more, and that's obviously not where he's at his best. So a lot of learning to do, but gee, he's been impressive for parts tonight. Very, very impressive, I think.
Well, at the start of this tournament, he hadn't beaten a player in the top 50 in the world. Did on Tuesday and Thursday, and now playing number one. So it's been a sharp curve.
Leighton, your Davis Cup team's starting to look a little better as well.
Yeah,
here
absolutely.
All of a sudden, huh?
Well, we're in the qualifying Asia zones this year, so it's... It's still a long way back for us to get back to the world group, but that's obviously, we've got the new captain in Patrick Rafter, and that's going to be the next challenge for him to get us back in the world group, and hopefully we'll be able to do some damage in the next two or three years. Good hitting all round. Bernard was able to change the pace there. He was able to pick his balls to attack off, and then he hit a great slice backhand from a mid-court ball.
30 on.
Rafa's so good at so many things, but one of his main strengths out there without actually hitting balls is he plays to his clock. He takes his time when he needs to. He had a long point to go 15-30 down where he did a lot of scrambling, and he took his time. Some of the lesser ranked players would have gone up there and rushed through, and he was able to get a cheap error out of Bernard.
Now
there's the evidence to average time between service points, and that's pushing the limits, isn't it? 29 seconds? Pushing the rules a little bit?
It is a little bit. Well, when you're world number one, who's going to tell you?
That's an opportunity lost on that passing shot there. He went right down the middle with it. Rafa's hands are just too good. You're not going to get away with that. You got to pick a line and go for it.
If he was going to go out the middle, he had to go a lot harder.
There's a little better.
Advantage, Tomic.
You know, his anticipation is awfully good, Bernard. He covers up a lot of that foot speed with the anticipation. I mean, so often tonight, you know, with the power that Nadal's hit the ball, I thought he'd be out of position more, but he's there quite often.
That's heavy hitting.
It just draws to mind Rafa standing in front of a punching bag and just boom, 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 body blow, body blow, body blow, because not only did he win the point, and it was a pretty crucial one at break point, he's taken the wind out of Tomic's sails with that one. He is huffing and puffing.
He takes so many players' legs away as a match wears on, and he knows how physically fit he is. He's done the work, and he'll back himself with anyone over five sets he wins once it gets to the fifth set.
Advantage, Nadal.
That serve out wide, you could really see it. Tomic had nothing in the explosive department in his legs. He just couldn't get out to it. Jello. That's that feeling. I've been there. It's not a good one.
Yeah.
So, keeps the serve, keeps the advantage, two sets and two love.
Nadal leads two games to love.
And let's go into the press and have a little listen to Samantha Stosur after her loss tonight.
Yeah, I'm obviously very disappointed to not win, but actually thought I played really well. So it's hard to walk off the court thinking that you played well, and you know, I was so close to winning that first set, and then don't really know how I lost it, to be honest. I felt like I'd started playing a bit better and was probably on top of her, and then all of a sudden it was gone and I was a set down, and I thought she played extremely well pretty much the whole way through. So I think it was a match of a point here and a point there, and she got the ones that really mattered. And so it's a tough loss, but I think I can, you know, walk off thinking I played quite well and did everything that I could.
Sam led 5-3 in the tiebreak. It was the crucial point. Talked about five sets.
15-0.
Two players have beaten Nadal ever over five sets. Federer twice, and you're the other, like.
Yeah, well, I remember that match well, because somehow I think it was about the only time I've ever seen Rafa start cramping at the start of the fifth set. So
let me give you a high five.
That felt good.
Oh my gosh.
No, so it was. He was still very young in his career. It was back in 2005, right here on Rod Laver Arena.
Just so important you can get some games in this final set. I mean, said miracles can happen. We'll need one here, but important he doesn't fall away here, and it doesn't look like he is.
No, so far so good. He's been able to keep in these first three games of this third set after losing that second set after leading a double break. But that's one question mark over Bernard. I think in the past, even some of the matches he's won over five sets, when he's been down an early break, he does occasionally throw that set away and get ready for the next one, which is really completely opposite to the person he's playing down the other end tonight.
But we're getting to know him better, Tomic, aren't we, with all these big matches, and he's on the board in the finals. I did say 2-1 in the final set as they went to sit down. Who knows? This is the third set of this match.
Ready
for you did chastise me late, and that never say die attitude of yours.
Yeah, but you could be right. It could be the final. We don't know yet.
Hoping it's not, because Bernard's been in most of these games, hasn't he, all the way through. So tomorrow night, Petkovic and Sharapova. That's really interesting. Mm-hmm. And Leighton, you're coming back for Roddick and Ravinka.
I am. I'm looking forward to that one too. I haven't seen a lot of Andy this tournament, but I think normally this is the stage of the tournament when he'll really try and step it up a notch.
He's the last American.
Clean hitting there to go up the line and really flatten it out that time.
15-0.
We just saw Rafa's shoes in a close image there, and that's actually the 09 obviously stands for his tournament win here at Melbourne Park when he was able to win that epic match against Roger Federer. He's had French Open shoes. I'm not sure if there's enough room on them anymore to keep putting the the French Open trophies on them, but
got a flag on on all the majors now, which is such a rare feat. There's another look at it. And you think about it, you know, all the great players that didn't do that. The Sampras's, the McEnroes, the Lindels, the Connors. You have so many great champions who weren't able to win that fourth one to give themselves the full lot of it. Edberg.
Korea.
Thanks, Fitz. A little charity is good. Good too, but what a time to have to compete, Leighton, against these two players and Federer and Rafa, guys that have been able to do that, to win all four of them. What an interesting time to be a part of the circuit.
Well, it's a great time, but it's a tough time too, because it's frustrating, because a few of us might have had a couple more Grand Slams if we, obviously, a few years ago didn't run into Roger in every major, and now Rafa's sort of taken over from him, so it's not easy out there.
Oh, nice. Well, I'll tell you this. Federer and Nadal are probably two of the nicest champions that you'll ever see in a sport, but they're greedy.
Yeah.
Very, very greedy people.
They're so good for our sport, though. Yeah. Not only on the court, but off the court. Rafa's one of the most, for everything that he's done on the court, he's so humble. And I know you used that word earlier. And his uncle Tony and obviously his family's kept him so well grounded. And
Tomic. Couple of lapses, four love in that second set. He'll think about that for a while.
Yeah, against any world number one at the time, you just can't afford to have any cheap points, and especially when you've got that opportunity to really consolidate a break out there, you've got to take them. That's an amazing forehand from Rafa. He was in the doubles alley when he's played that. He was nearly running into our bunker here on courtside. And for him to pull that all the way down the line, knowing that he has to nearly hit a perfect shot, otherwise the point's over. Bernard was going to have a pass of three quarters of the court. And that's the belief that he has in his game.
Bruce, I want you guys in there to work out who the seven guys are. I know you know, Bruce. You've got all the stats in your head. But ask those other two guys there. Do they know who the seven guys that have won all four majors off the top of their head without looking it up?
I'll have a crack at that.
We've got Agassi's one.
Yeah.
Federer and Nadal.
Laver.
Your turn, Jim.
Laver. Tilden. Or is it? No, it's Budge, I think.
It's not Tilden.
It's Budge, I think, yeah.
He's missed it. So Nadal, here's a break point now.
On the right, far sideline.
He has
ball's called out.
Challenged Perry and Emerson are the other two, because this is too important right now. Okay. So we've got him, Fitz, but here we go. So, pressing here.
It gives Bernhard a good opportunity here to really go after it and try and get back on even pegging in this third set.
Thank you.
Deuce. He brings it when he needs to, doesn't he? 194Ks down the tee. He hits his spots. And I think that's what you were talking about earlier, Jim, with his slightly different technique. He's able to flatten it out a little bit more.
That was 194K. That's good pop.
Correct me if I'm wrong, I don't feel like he's had a great serving night, but he has served aces when it's been at a critical point.
Fairly low percentage, 56.
Advantage Nadal.
Yeah, it's not going to be a good night when he gets his serve broken a couple of times and what could possibly, Bruce, be a three-set match.
Yep, that's right. Heading that way. He's had 7 break points, Tomic, through the match.
Yeah, look, Rafa doesn't look happy out there. He's definitely still trying to work his game into this tournament. And as we pointed out, this is really his first challenge of the tournament in the third round. And that's a horrendous miss on the second there for him. Mishit that ball.
Jim, what credit do you give to Tomic? Because he made Chardy look awful. He made Lopez look awful.
Well, I give a lot of credit to Tomic. I mean, it's not Tomic's... He's not imposing himself on Rafa's serve to force a double fault like that necessarily, but when you play someone who makes you feel awkward, which is what Tomic tries to do, and I think he's awfully successful at it, sometimes it can throw you a little bit out of your rhythm in all areas. It certainly makes you work mentally, for sure. Sneaky. You know, Brad Gilbert wrote a book called Winning Ugly.
Yeah, I read that a long time ago.
Yeah. And he was quoted this week saying that he thinks Tomic's going to be a big player and soon. And I don't necessarily agree fully with the soon part because I think there's a lot of physical work ahead of him. But, you know, BG sees a lot of himself in this. I mean, this is a player who we'll definitely try and bring the other players' level down to win. It's a different brand of tennis. It's very interesting to watch. Break point.
Sebastian, number one against number 199, 477 career wins against 7 career wins.
Deuce number 5.
Tomic is challenging the call on the left far sideline. The ball is called out.
One thing Rafa does so well, especially in Grand Slams, is he gets better with every match. The better the opponent, the better he comes out and plays. And this ball's just wide to give Rafa game point here on his serve. Try and take a 3-1 lead in his third set. But a classic example of that, I think, was Wimbledon last year, where I didn't think he was playing his best tennis through that first week, but he found a way to beat the lower-ranked opponents. He played himself into the tournament, then Rog bombed out, and the draw opened up for him, and he sensed his opportunity, and he played better against the better players. And when he had to end up with Murray, he played one of his best matches in the semi.
It was a long one, but he's held on to 3-1.
Nadal leads 3-1.
Well, that's Novak Djokovic, I think, after an easy day. When he got a forfeit, he's dancing with one of the Dancing with the Stars experts, Kim Johnson.
Gee, you know a lot about this show.
Yeah, well, she actually danced against Beck in Beck's Dancing with the Stars series on Channel 7 back in the first series. So I think, Bruce, you should be putting your hand up to do the next series, mate.
You are kidding.
Come on, Bruce.
Do you know how old I am? Get off.
It'd be special.
You're ridiculous. I need a hip operation. I'm 58 this year.
I think Layden brought actually a pair of shoes for you to start training.
Move on. Pushing wide on that forehand a lot tonight, hasn't he?
Well, I still like that play. I like him when he flattens that backhand out.
15 on.
It's hard to get Rafa playing that squash shot where he's just got to scrap back into the point because he moves so well behind the baseline. But if you can do it, that's Bernard stood in the court and he's hit a short angle with that as well, which is even better.
Oh my goodness, come on now. That makes me so angry to see a player hit a shot that good. Well, you watch Nadal get caught a little bit out of position on this overhead, and he'll ad-lib a little flip shot mid-stride. He doesn't even leap at it, but this backhand is just absurd. I mean, that shot, you just cannot hit that shot, and yet he does it time and time again. It's really annoying. That makes me feel better. Thanks for a little mean version.
Tell that to the fans that paid their money to come in. They're really annoyed that he plays so brilliantly too. He just knows where he is on the court so well, doesn't he? I mean, that's an understatement, I know.
Well, very rarely does he seem out of position.
Yeah.
And that comes down to his great footwork out there.
It's going to be fascinating to hear what he thinks about the Tomic game, isn't it? First time he's had a look at it. Clever. It's Nadal with a break, but it is 3-2 in the third set.
Well, here's that irritating shot, the backhand of Nadal, and he just gets under it and drives it right in the sweet spot of the racket, full extension with the right arm there. And it is a devastating shot. A different shot than the forehand. Doesn't spin as much, penetrates more. But it is something special.
Changed his shirt, I think. What was the locker room talk about this match tonight?
Well, I was taking a little informal poll beforehand in locker room B, just chatting with the guys on how many games we thought that the youngster would get off of Rafa, and 9 was the line. That was the over-under. They thought he'd win somewhere right around 9 games. I had it personally at 7, which he's already gotten past. So he's done pretty well. From our standpoint, Layden, I'd love to get your thoughts on what you were thinking before.
Well, I didn't think he'd be up for love double break in that second set.
Nets for serve.
Yeah, my feeling was the first set could be tight and then he'd fall off physically, kind of 6-4, 2-1. What do you think? How many games?
15 love.
Yeah, I probably would have, probably 6 or 7, I think I would have said at the start.
And he's on 9 now.
But I would have been like you, though, thinking that the first set would have been the closest set.
Mm-hmm.
So he did well, really, after being in a lot of those games early in that first set to dig deep and be able to get up those 2 points in the second set. And
yeah,
he was the one that actually really let it slip in the end.
Well, that 6-2 first set is a very misleading number. You know, Bruce pointed out how close the games were. He was never worse than any of those games, so he was competitive from the start. We'll see Meltzer back Dattis at the conclusion of this one.
I wonder if that will play Murray.
Love.
If Rafa gets through this, he will play Marian Cilic in the round of 16, which I think Rafa will be feeling pretty good considering that Cilic went 9-7 in the fifth earlier today. That's John Isner.
He's got that game to love, so 4-2 in the third.
Nadal leads 4-2.
Quiet, please, as we serve something you've never seen before.
This is for the greatest of all, a chance of a new life.
Conviction Kitchen, time after the tennis.
Yeah, really looking forward to that. Just quickly on the Jacobs Creek, the three teenagers that have got to number two ever are Borg, Becker and Nadal. Leighton was the youngest number one ever at just over 20, but only three teenagers have got number two in the Open era. That's Borg, Becker and Nadal. And as we pointed out today on the women's, Maureen Conley won the Grand Slam as a teenager.
Little Mo, that was a nice pull, Bruce.
That's why I mentioned it.
It's amazing how far back Rafa does get to return some of those second serves, though. He's always looking to use his forehand. He wants to hit that high, heavy loop forehand and start the point on his terms.
It's
a pretty good pop, 143k on that forehand.
Yeah,
and another good pop, Jim. He served pretty well up to 11 aces now. 4-3. Bernard's been able to stay with Rafa in this final set. He's break down, but at 2-love, I think a lot of people might have thought this might have got away really quickly. So it's still the pressure on the scoreboard, isn't it?
Absolutely. It's still been a long set. Rafa will be looking to try and have another quick service game, same as his last one.
Lofoten.
What surprised you the most about Tomic tonight?
Well, for me, I think his game plan's been a lot better because he's known that he wasn't going to be able to slice the round and play such a finesse game against Rafa, because as soon as Rafa starts dictating play, he was going to have his running shoes on all night. So I feel like he's really stepped up since his first and second round wins. He's mixed the slicing well, but he hasn't overplayed it.
15 on.
Jim, temperament-wise, how do you think the 18-year-old stood up?
Well, I think temperament-wise, he's been good. No complaints at all. He's just played ball. He's kept his head down. He's been respectful of his opponent, but he's also come out to win. I think he's handled the moment exceptionally well. I would give him extremely high marks, given the circumstances, given the opponent, all of that. He is a big match player innately. He's shown that last year with Cilic, shown it again here.
30-15.
Now we'll see if his body and the rest of his game develops and allows him to play matches like this late in later stages. But the early indications here are good.
Next for serve.
I was really interested in this match to see what he was going to try and bring strategically, and I'm really pleased that Tomic has stepped up, like you were saying, taking the ball to Rafa, recognized what wouldn't work before it even didn't work. He had already worked out in his head, played the match in his head beforehand, and came in with a different strategy.
Too good. The off-pace angle, inside-out forehand. There's not many guys that can play that shot on the world tour, and Rafa does it better than most.
40-15.
Oh, come on. Let's be honest. It's that string.
Well, it definitely helps him, that's for sure. You can feel he's getting close to, obviously, the second week of another major.
Powerful serve, so it's Nadal 5-3 in the third.
Nadal leads 5-3.
Quiet, please. The new Aussie drama is set to make quite a racket. Winners and losers. Premieres after the tennis on 7.
So his first match was 6-love, 5-love. His second 6-2, 6-1, 6-1 against Ryan Sweeting, the young American qualifier. So this is certainly the longest and most competitive match he's faced. Tomic has kept with him for so much of the way, almost 2.5 hours.
Love the team.
And he wants to try and finish this game off strongly and try and hold here and make Rafa serve for it. Make him serve it out. And that just shows how competitive he is. He's nearly got this match wrapped up, but he wants to get in the locker room and do his interview with Jim as quickly as possible.
Thinking about those questions.
I'm panicking, as usual.
How's your Spanish?
No bueno.
Well, this will be a good hold after being love 15 down in this game.
It was a sweet touch, wasn't it, then?
Yeah.
40-30.
Well, he got him with the point before, bringing Rafa forward, but he knew straight away off the racket that that one didn't quite have the height and depth that he needed.
Johnny's father and coach.
Needs a couple of big first serves here to get himself out of trouble in this game.
And he got the serve in, but he missed the forehand. So we come to match point. A lot of people would have thought this was an inevitable moment today, but it's been a great journey getting there. Fascinating to watch. Let's see if we can hang on and save this.
Right, please.
So the champion wins, but the teenager gains a lot of respect here tonight. 6-2, 7-5, 6-3. It was a good match.
Yeah, it was a good match. I think Rafa will be extremely happy to get away with it, obviously, in straight sets and move through to another fourth round encounter here at Melbourne Park. He looks in good nick. I think he can still go up another notch or two, though, as the second week progresses, and he's going to have to against Marion Cilic in the next round.
Fitzy, I think you can hear me. I mean, is that as well as you've seen Bernard play? Is that a fair bit to do with him?
Yeah, no doubt. I think when you take into consideration, Bruce, and I am struggling to hear, it's a big crowd here, but I think taking into consideration, he's on the court with the number one player in the world. That would have been easily, I would say, the best he's ever played. And proves beyond doubt that he can play on a big stage, and he's capable. I was surprised at how much he was able to penetrate. I know he got 10 games, I think it was 10 games in the end, but he penetrated against the world's best, and it was impressive.
It's a great reception. It must be a strange feeling for him. He'd have to be a bit disappointed to have lost, but pleased in a way, do you think?
Oh, he's going to take a lot away from this match, no matter what happened, and obviously the crowd loves Rafa out there, and he'll be looking forward to doing the interview with Jim in a couple of moments. But Bernard's got a lot of positives to take away from tonight. I think he stepped it up. He played a different style of game, different game plan than he played in his first two matches. He realised before he went out that he obviously wouldn't be able to just push the ball around and wait for Rafa to make errors. So he tried to take it to him, and that was his best chance of doing well against the world number one.
Very quickly, is Rafa at where he should be halfway through?
He's still in the tournament and he hasn't dropped a set, so he's looking pretty good to me, but I expect him to get better as the second week comes along, and I think he'd be pretty happy. He hasn't wasted a lot of energy so far, which is a good sign as well.
Great call, Leighton. Looking forward to working with you tomorrow night with Roddick.
Thanks,
Alan's on his way to gym.
Rafa, you're such a gentleman when you're playing, and at the end of the match, you did something that I've seen you do a few times, but you showed great respect to your opponent. You applauded him as he was walking off the court. What do you think about this young man? He played a pretty darn good match against you tonight.
Well, first of all, just congratulate him. I think he's improving every year a lot. He's very young, and if he is able to keep practicing and keep improving like this, he's going to have big chances to be in the top positions very soon.
Well, that's where you are right now, so probably not too soon from your perspective. So the first set was 6-2, but was close. He played well. For love, second set, he had you. What were you thinking?
We're gonna try to win the third. That's what I was thinking. So, yeah. I think I started the match playing well, but he's this kind of player that he makes you play bad, no? Because he play very, very easy. His position on court is perfect. It's very difficult to move him from the baseline. So, I just, in the end of the match, I think I did something better. No, I was going to the net more times. That's the way that I have to play if I want to have chances to play better and better. Because from the baseline today, I didn't have enough good shots to destroy him.
Have you to destroy him? That's nice.
Was the only word in English that I didn't know another one.
I think we got the point. Well, he's a different kind of player, and so it took you, seems like it took you maybe a few sets to understand what to do against him, but now it'll be easy from now on, right? No problem?
I would love that, but that's not going to happen. Every time going to be more and more difficult, I'm sure of that. He's very young and he's going to improve a lot in a few months and a few years, so I'm sure it's going to be a big rival.
Let's talk about your game. Where do you feel like your game is for this tournament? Are you happy with the way you're playing? Are there things you want to improve?
I have to play a little bit better if I really want to keep having chances to go to the quarterfinals. I think I'm going to have a difficult match against Cilic. I'm not playing bad, no, but I have to play a little bit more aggressive, a little bit longer, and play closer to the lines, no, because I am playing too straight, in my opinion.
When you were 17, you had an experience like this. You played Leighton Hewitt on this court in 2004. And it's similar to what Tomek had with you tonight. It's a learning experience. It's something to learn from. Do you remember that match with Leighton?
Sure, no, it was in 2004 and 2005. 2004, I think it was 7-6, 7-6, 6-3, something like this.
Exactly.
And in 2005, it was close. No, I had a good chance in the fourth. I lost in the fifth, finally. No, so it was fantastic experience for me to play here at the home of Leighton with fantastic crowd. So this kind of matches, I think, is very important to improve your level. No, and after that match, I started to play unbelievable 2005. And since that match, I think my career was better and better.
Yeah, it's been pretty good. So tonight, we're watching your match, and you know, we sit in the bunker here, and there was another commentator tonight. Do you recognize that guy in there?
I didn't see him now.
It's Leighton Hewitt.
Oh, yeah. I saw him in the locker room before. I didn't know that he was going to be commenting the match.
Yeah, he was judging you. He was judging you a lot. Yeah. But he thought you played well. So did I. Congratulations. It was a fun match. Rafael Nadal continues the quest.
So Rafael Nadal, safe through the fourth round for the sixth time here at Melbourne Park. You play Marin Cilic, who actually has beaten Rafa the only other time that they have met. Well, we've got some more great action coming your way tomorrow night from Rod Laver Arena as Rafa signs off for this evening. Two absolute glamazons of the sport in Andrea Petkovic of Germany and Maria Sharapova of Russia, the 30th seed against the 14th seed, Sharapova, the 2008 champion. And that match is going to be followed by Andy Roddick, who takes on Stanislav Wawrinka, who was so impressive against Gael Monfils, who's the Swiss number two. So two fantastic matches from 7 p.m.